This new OMG particle is too powerful to make sense. Everything in the universe is made of atoms, and every atom is made of particles. These are the building blocks of all things. Everything you see around you is nothing else than agglomerates of particles. This is what you ultimately are, a giant, funny ensemble of particles. They are very different from each other, electrons, protons, and neutrons, just to name a few. But some of them are insanely special, and therefore, puzzling. In this video, we're going to talk about the Amaterasu particle. This was a cosmic ray detected in 2021. It took scientists 2 years to identify it, but now we know it possessed an energy exceeding 240 exa-electronvolts. And even more exciting, it came from the local void, a region in the universe that, as far as we know, is essentially empty. So how the heck was this particle produced? Keep watching the video to get to know more about it. Cosmic rays. What are they? Let's start by saying that cosmic rays are not actually rays. They are particles, very powerful ones, I must admit. So just like any other quantum object, such as photons or electrons, they can be described as waves and as particles. The term ray seems to have arisen from an initial belief. These particles have such a high penetrating power that scientists tried to describe them as rays, cutting through everything they meet along their way. But their way to and from where? Well, since we can detect them, their destination is the Earth. Right at this moment, your house, your car, your cat, and your body are being crossed by thousands of particles like these, and you don't even notice. However, it's not like Earth's special anyway. These particles are going everywhere in the universe. That's not the problem. The $1 million question is to understand where they come from. In 1912, scientist Victor Hess took some balloons to be sent high in the atmosphere and recorded the amount of radiation received at different altitudes. He noticed the balloons were being hit by powerful radiation, and the higher he went, the stronger the cosmic rays. These experiments awarded him the 1936 Nobel Prize in Physics. What we know today is that most cosmic rays detected on Earth originate from the Sun. They go by the name solar cosmic rays, and specifically, they originate in the Sun's chromosphere. Actually, they correlate relatively well with solar flares. One of the first effects we might expect to observe is then a correlation between solar activity and the flux of cosmic rays detected. In other words, there will be periods where the detected amount of cosmic rays is high and others where it is lower, and this might be connected to the Sun's cycles. Not only that, experiments have shown how the Earth gets hit by these powerful particles even during the night when the Sun is not in the sky. There's one simple explanation for this. Some cosmic rays originate from outside the solar system in our own galaxy. But even more exciting, some of them might originate from distant galaxies. Picture it, millions and millions of particles departing from regions in their home galaxies, traveling at the speed of light just like a flock of ultra-high-speed comrades, hurtle through the cosmic expanses of the universe for thousands of years, only to hit the Earth and whatever crossed their path. This is romantic and creepy at the same time. Indeed, these particles are so powerful that they can cause problems for our satellites and computers. And in the long run, they can even change the atmospheric chemistry of our planet. Take computers. Data is stored in the form of bits, often referred to as ones and zeros. But cosmic rays are capable of reversing some of these bits, altering the data and causing a software error. This is why the IBM company started a whole campaign to understand how much of the PC errors were due to cosmic rays on average. And this is also the reason why we now make use of resistive memories in our laptops. These are especially important when it comes to space applications. But how do they do that? How do cosmic rays change the bits in our computers? Well, in the exact same way they change our atmosphere, through ionization. In the atmosphere, for example, oxygen and nitrogen molecules are present. They're having the time of their lives, floating and vibing. But when a cosmic ray hits, they ionize these molecules, and this leads to a number of crazy chemical reactions. Among the subproducts of this kind of reaction are elements like tritium, beryllium, chlorine, and krypton. Superman would not be happy about it, I guess. However, it's not like all cosmic rays get through. Most of them are actually shielded. By what, you might ask? by the Earth's magnetic field to start off. Earth and cosmic rays. The Earth's magnetic field is a complex dynamic force field that surrounds the Earth and is created by the movement of molten iron in the Earth's core. The Earth's magnetic field is shaped like an oblate spheroid, with a slight tilt relative to the Earth's axis of rotation. One of the main functions of the Earth's magnetic field is to shield the Earth from cosmic radiation. It acts as a barrier, protecting the Earth and its inhabitants from the harmful effects of these particles. When solar wind and cosmic radiation particles enter the Earth's magnetic field, they are deflected and redirected away from the Earth rather than hitting the Earth's surface. The Earth's magnetic field is not a perfect shield, however. Some solar wind and cosmic radiation particles are able to penetrate the Earth's magnetic field and reach the Earth's surface. So it might be nice to have another shielding layer, don't you think? Well, as a matter of fact, we do have one. It's the termination shock, a region of the heliosphere where the solar wind and cosmic radiation slow down due to interactions with the interstellar medium. It actually seems to act like a barrier protecting us from almost 90% of cosmic rays coming from outside of the solar system. Imagine the termination shock as a sphere that protects us. This sphere shrinks or grows bigger depending on the sun's activity. In other words, there might be periods where the shielding is not so effective due to a shrinking of the termination shock. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve it for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. Where do cosmic rays come from? So now bear with me, cause things are about to get wild. Decades of measurements have helped scientists map out the energy spectrum of cosmic rays observed from Earth. This famous plot, shown in this figure, reveals a remarkable power law in energy across a wide range. At a certain energy level known as the Ni, there is a break in this power law. Below the Ni, cosmic rays are thought to originate from within our galaxy, but the exact sources remain a mystery. Scientists refer to sources capable of accelerating particles to crazy high energies, called PEV energies, as PEVatrons, and astronomers are actively searching for these extreme accelerators within our galaxy. There are strong indications that the fast shock waves produced by exploding stars, known as supernova remnants, could be the sites where cosmic rays accelerate. However, it is still possible that other scenarios related to electron acceleration cannot be ruled out. Therefore, SNRs have not yet been confirmed as galactic PEVatrons, and this hypothesis remains open. Understanding the origin of cosmic rays using direct measurements is an impossible task due to the presence of interstellar magnetic fields that deviate the path of these charged particles before they reach Earth. Neutral messengers generated by cosmic ray interactions, such as gamma rays and neutrinos, are used to determine the origin of cosmic rays. Take, for instance, the most powerful particle ever detected, the OMG particle. It was the night of October 15, 1991. The Fly's Eye experiment of the University of Utah detected something called an air shower, a miles-long explosion of streaming particles invisible to the human eye. This was caused by high-energy interactions in the upper atmosphere. When scientists looked at the data, they must have thought it was a dream. Never a particle had been recorded to possess such high energy, more than 10 to the 12th electron volts. The results were so shocking, the article was named the OMG particle. More recent studies using the Telescope Array Project have suggested a source of the particles within a 20-degree radius warm spot in the direction of the constellation Ursa Major. Since the first observation, hundreds of similar events have been recorded, confirming that that was not an error in the measurements, and that such ultra-high-speed particles actually exist, and are produced somewhere in the universe in what are thought to be warm spots for the creation of cosmic rays. In 2021, scientists made another significant discovery in the field of particle physics, the Amaterasu particle. This particle, named after the sun goddess in Japanese mythology, was found once again at the Telescope Array in Utah. While slightly less powerful than the previously discovered OMG particle, the Amaterasu particle claimed the second spot on the podium. Unlike the OMG particle, which is believed to originate from a specific location in the universe, studies on the Amaterasu particle indicate that it may come from the local void, an empty region bordering the Milky Way galaxy. For further information on the voids in our galaxy, feel free to watch our previous video by clicking the link in the description. The energy of this particle was a million times more than particles produced in the Large Hadron Collider, the most powerful accelerator ever built on Earth. Toshihiro Fuji, an associate professor at Osaka Metropolitan University in Japan, said, "When I first discovered this ultra-high-energy cosmic ray, I thought there must have been a mistake, as it showed an energy level unprecedented in the last three decades. The crazy Amaterasu particle and the GKZ limit." The OMG particle and the Amaterasu particle are both examples of what are known as ultra-high-energy cosmic rays, or UHECRs. Even though it is very hard to understand where these particles come from and where exactly they originated, the Greyson-Zaltzman-Kuzmin GZK theory could help us constrain their origin by means of the GZK limit. This is a theoretical upper limit on the energy of cosmic rays originating from outside our galaxy. It is named after the physicist Kenneth Greyson, Gregory Zaltzman, and Vadim Kuzmin, who independently proposed the limit in the 1960s. The GZK limit is based on the interaction of high-energy cosmic rays, particularly protons, with the cosmic microwave background, CMB radiation. The cosmic microwave background is a faint glow of radiation that permeates the universe and is a remnant of the Big Bang. As high-energy cosmic rays travel through space, they can collide with these CMB photons. According to the GZK limit, when a cosmic ray with extremely high energy, on the order of 10 to the 19th electron volts or higher, interacts with a CMB photon, it can create a particle called a pion. This process is known as the GZK interaction. The pions produced in this interaction eventually decay into lower energy particles, including neutrinos. The key implication of the GZK limit is that if ultra-high energy cosmic rays were coming from extremely distant sources outside our galaxy, they would have undergone multiple interactions with the CMB along their journey. These interactions would result in a significant loss of energy, making it highly unlikely for cosmic rays with energies beyond the GZK limit to reach Earth from sources outside the Milky Way. Cosmic rays with energies beyond the GZK limit are expected to be significantly attenuated by interactions with the CMB, making their detection on Earth less probable if they originated from very distant sources. This is one of the reasons why researchers look for sources of ultra-high-energy cosmic rays within our galaxy or its immediate vicinity. That's all for this video. As we conclude our celestial journey, feel free to share your thoughts on this video in the comments below, and stay tuned for our next adventure. We'll see you soon on the channel.